pocket to buy some juice. You gotta bring your own bags and you learn to reduce your waste. We gotta learn to reduce. And if your brother or your sister's got some cool clothes, you could try them on before you buy some more of those. Reuse. We gotta learn to reuse. And if the first two R's don't work out, and if you gotta make some trash, well don't throw it out. Recycle. We gotta learn to recycle. We gotta learn to reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Good morning. Welcome to Building Green. My name is Bill Vitale. I'm your host, and the program airs 10 a.m. the fourth Tuesday of each month. This program is being recorded. It's not just a coincidence that Scot Case and I have the same shirt on as we did last month. My guest today is Scot Case, who returns for a second half hour to continue our discussion. Last month, we discussed sort of the broad principles and definitions, the many definitions of sustainability. This month, we're going to kind of touch on that just for a second, and then Scot is going to then tell us about some of the interviews that he conducted and sort of salient outcomes from those interviews in preparation of the report that we mentioned last month. Report on sustainability. This is what the cover looks like. You can get a hard copy at Berks Nature. Their offices and their very fine building are located in Angelica Park in Reading, or you can go to berksnature.org and there's a PDF online.
Correct.
Very, very readable, very easy to read it online. But if you do want to have your own copy, and there's a ton of valuable information and insights in here, and Scot is the principal author of this document, and that's in part what this discussion is about. So without rambling on too much, Scot, thanks for agreeing to be on in both segments.
Thank you.
One of the things we talked about near the end of the last half hour was sustainability means, and I think one of the definitions that you gave was something you got from one of your interviews. So let's use that as our springboard, and let's bring that slide up again.
We'll bring that slide up again temporarily. I think one of the most valuable lessons I learned in talking with the business executives from 60 different local companies. Many of them weren't familiar with the environmental language around sustainability, but one gentleman, after a good 90-minute conversation, finally kind of looked at me in this wonderful Dutchy accent and said, "Well, I don't know about all that, but it sure sounds like good old-fashioned Pennsylvania Dutch common sense to me." And I think that's become my definition moving forward.
Yeah, so we
can ditch the graphic, but...
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that we're going to go through now several examples. What they sort of illustrate principles or aspects of sustainability. But the way you prepared the report is you kind of focused on a company or two, not only private sector, but nonprofits and places like Kutztown University, the things that they were doing that whether they defined it for themselves as sustainability or not, they certainly fit within that broad definition of or definitions of sustainability. So let's get into it. I know that one of the first things. I guess before, is there anything by way of background or broad scope we need to? Scot's credentials. He kind of rolled through his history last month, and we won't do that again. So you can find this and any other program from BCTV at the website, at the YouTube, BCTV's YouTube channel, so you can stream any of these programs at any time, anywhere in the world, as long as you get access to the internet. So we won't do that. Is there anything else before we start getting into specifics?
No, right. I think we should dive in. Okay. I think a lot of the report ended up being structured around the question we were talking about last month,
right, exactly.
Which was really, what does sustainability mean?
Right.
And
I think recycling is a good place to start, and I think Scott has, a nice graphic to it. Go ahead.
A quick little graphic, right, that sustainability means more recycling. What was interesting, and we can kill the graphic at this point, but what was interesting is when I was trying to explain to people, well, what is sustainability? Because so few people were familiar with the language of sustainability. One of the first things I would throw out is, well, you know, recycling. And everyone had a recycling story of some sort. And so it was interesting to kind of hear the volumes of recycling that are out there. I remember being particularly impressed talking with Jim Boscov. And Jim Boscov was explaining, oh, they had started a recycling program at Boscov's because they heard you could make a little bit of money doing it. Always trying to save us money by, making money.
Yeah.
So what they did is they actually set up a competition amongst the different stores and the different distribution centers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So people were actually competing to see how much of the stuff they gathered could be recycled. And so the actual statistics and numbers are in this report, but it was kind of an innovative little twist on, hey, we can make money recycling, let's do that, and let's create an incentive for more and more people to do that. I also talked with the people over at, say Kugel's Recycling. They make it possible for all of us to recycle.
Right, because
basically
the place where most of the stuff goes. Right?
That's where a lot of it goes. They can work with companies to set up recycling programs. They can help companies make money doing recycling. And they kind of walked me through all the economics of it. So whereas, I was all excited because, it's sustainability related. We're protecting the earth. We're being efficient with our resources. A lot of the local, Pennsylvania Dutch perspective was, it does all that. But it's also smart not to waste stuff. And hey, you can make money doing it. So sustainability means more recycling. And there's a lot of good examples in the
report. Not to dwell on recycling, but I know in the report, one of the companies you did talk to and mention was Ethosource.
Mm-hmm.
Which maybe just quickly mention what it is they do, because I dealt with them on a couple of projects, and I just think that's a good example of a company that, partly on principle, but mostly because they saw that there was a market, you can say what it is.
Yeah, absolutely. So Ethosource is a wonderful company that basically recycles furniture for a living.
Yeah.
So when they go down into,
office furniture,
so you go into an office in Philadelphia and the company is moving or has gone bankrupt or is just changing out their furniture, Ethosource will actually take all of that furniture, take it back to a warehouse, clean it up, polish it up, fix it, repair it, and then they resell it to somebody else.
Yeah.
So you end up, someone like me can then, when I'm filling out an office suite, can buy recycled furniture at a huge savings. Ethosource has made money, and we've kept all sort of stuff out of the landfill. So again, sustainability means recycling.
And haven't used up the energy and resources to produce new stuff. And one of the things they do is they refurbish Herman Miller office systems, I think, as I recall.
Absolutely.
But I went to their, I had them on this program years ago. But I went down to their place in Morgantown. I was just like, oh my God.
Exactly.
I mean, the volume of stuff, you think like, oh, well, it's a few square feet. It's like thousands and thousands and thousands. I mean, it's mind-boggling, and they collect stuff from a wide range area, and they're located in Berks County. And beyond their business, the owners are involved
good
in all
people.
Kinds of other stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's part of the sustainability, sustaining the broader community, not only their company.
But even like the Reading Hospital is recycling all sorts of stuff. The college campuses are recycling. So there's a bunch of different good stories in here.
Yeah.
And again, because there's a good environmental story, but also because there's a good practical, Pennsylvania Dutch practical approach
and,
to it.
And really at a time, we're dwelling on recycling, but there was a time when there were arguments, just like there are about climate change. But places like Reading Hospital, Kutztown University, these large institutions, it's just part of what they do. There's not even any, it's part and parcel of how they operate. They've just incorporated that into their whole business model
and
mission.
Young college students, the millennials entering the workforce and stuff, they just expect it.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be, what kind of dinosaur company are you if you're not recycling? So for a millennial, that's just kind of, you must be really backwards if you're not.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that illustrates a lot of things. Well, let's try to move along. So the next thing, I think, is saving energy.
Mm.
And again, there are a number of places you can talk about that, but Why don't you give us a little bit, some examples of where you had that conversation? And
sure. So there were a couple of good examples here. One, saving energy is all about being less wasteful.
Did they show this image?
Not yet. You can bounce the image up.
Just bring this image up and then take it off. Thanks.
So this is, you know, sustainably means renewable power, which is very, very connected to reducing energy use. So what a lot of organizations are doing is, first step is reduce the amount of energy that they're using as much as possible. So just cut energy use, installing more energy efficient lighting, installing more energy efficient air conditioning and heating equipment, installing more energy efficient equipment, factory level equipment, the big refrigerated cases in, say, a Redner's, the lights in any facility. So once you've cut your energy use, then it becomes even more affordable to bounce over and purchase renewable energy.
Right.
So there are a lot of different stories in the report of companies that cut their energy use because they were looking to save money, they were looking to reduce waste. And then a few companies that took the next step and said, hey, it's even cheaper now to run my facility off of solar power. So there's actually a couple of local companies, RER Energy Group, which has done a lot of solar installations throughout the country, but right here in Berks County. A company like MISCO, that I think we might have time to talk about later, solar panels on the roof of their factory. Several of the Boscovs have solar panels on the roof. Why? Because it makes good business sense.
Yeah.
You're getting the free energy from the sun, and the installation of the panels is cheaper because you've already cut your energy use. So now you have to buy fewer panels in order to... So it's a fun story. There was a lot more of that in Berks County than I was expecting.
That's interesting. Yeah, most serious solar installers, the first thing they do when they sit down with potential clients is, we have to look at how to cut your electricity use.
Absolutely.
which even that step in the process is good before you even go to putting in a panel. All right, well, kind of a natural step into building green. And we have a number of examples now of certified or bona fide green buildings. There was a lot of green construction that didn't go through any kind of regulatory review process like LEED. But we do have a number of buildings that do have a LEED or are pursuing a LEED rating. So
absolutely. So you can show the graphic. The most recent green building here in Berks County. They are probably going to get a green, a LEED silver rating. For those of you that don't recognize it, this is the Berks Nature Place out in Angelica Park. So you can kind of bounce away from that. But green buildings are the embodiment of all these sustainability principles. So you want the most energy efficient, you want maximizing recycled content, reducing water use. And it feels strange talking about this with you because you did a lot of this.
Yeah, it's a good reminder.
In fact, though, what I didn't realize when I was doing the interviews, I talked with the folks at C.H. Briggs. C.H. Briggs, for those that don't know, they provide building materials all across the country, including green building materials. And as they were telling me about their business and what they do, you know, they're selling building materials, green building materials. I'm in this gorgeous, beautiful building. I said, this is a green building. Oh yeah, your name comes up. You designed that facility for them before the LEED standard exists. So,
well, it may have existed, but it certainly wasn't being used here. I don't even think I knew about it at that time. I think there were just some initial conversations they're starting to put LEED together. Yeah, again, because it was just something that made sense, and the clients, the owners of Briggs were totally on board with that approach.
What was fascinating, listening to the folks at CH Briggs, you designed a beautiful green building for them, which actually changed the way they think about the built environment. So they actually began accelerating their variety of green building products they were selling.
Their
salespeople could go out and say, hey, buy from us. We really believe in this stuff. We believe in it so much. Hey, check out our facility. So there were some neat connections. But
it's true. Yeah,
but
that's exactly how.
What's the list? So there's the Nature Place, Berks County Community Foundation.
Yeah. The Opportunity House has a LEED certified building, mm-hmm. Berks Mm-hmm. Crisis LEED, and I can't remember what level that is. It might be at it's above certified, and I can't remember what level that is.
Lowers Park Elementary School
has LEED. There's a environmental studies building at Albright.
At Albright, right across the
is LEED certified.
Green Valley Elementary School and the Wilson School
District. That's right. There are a number of school buildings, and it's escaping my mind. There are a couple of others. I mean, we're not flooded with them. Now, there are some other buildings, including some we did after the LEED certification came into place. We did some offices. We did medical offices for Arthritis and Osteoporosis Center. We followed the LEED guidelines in the design of that project. They didn't see the merit in going through the review process expense, but everything we did in that office fit out was LEED. And there are a number of projects like that are being done. Now, and I think Amanda Stout might be, I don't think Catherine Kelly pursued LEED certification, but that building was designed according to LEED principles.
And I actually spent some time talking with Michael Cowder about those issues and with the folks over at Berkey Construction that have had their hands mm-hmm. in lots of projects, yep. including over at yep. Alvernia. And we had the kind of robust yep. conversation around, well, what is a green building and does it have to have a certification? And those kind of conversations were valuable and they're all kind of included in the report.
Yeah, and you mentioned Berkey. I mean, that's kind of an interesting illustration of what you'd said about Briggs. They were selected as the architect for construction company for the Berks County Community Foundation building, which was the first LEED Platinum building in the city of Reading. Now, I think some schools have been done in Berks County. They had not done a LEED, let alone a green building with any kind of focus like was going to happen with the Berks County Community Foundation. In that process, that was an educational process for them. Of course, you know, Eric Berkey, I guess he's not a millennial. He's older than a millennial, but he's a young guy for me.
Sorry, Eric.
and other people in his company and many of the subs embraced it. And really, Berkey has become the go-to company to do green buildings now because they took it seriously. They learned in that process. They got some of their people accredited, and you know they similar to what happened at Briggs, they kind of become champions of this whole approach. They realized it just makes so much sense on many, many different fronts, not only from the notion of what's best for the planet.
Yeah, absolutely. So you kind of talked about the learning curve that the folks at Berkey kind of went through and that the community is going through, kind of learning about the benefits and the values. And that kind of ties us over to the next one we were going to touch
education.
Based on. Education. So there's a quick picture here, but all of the local universities have some sort of active sustainability component. Why? One, because universities are all about preparing people for the future, so it makes sense to think about the future. But also, millennials care about this. So we can back away from the picture now, but the universities recognize if they want to attract students, they need to have courses on sustainability and environmental issues. They also need to have a campus that reflects some sort of sustainability ethic. And so all of the major ones near us, Kutztown, RAC, Alvernia, Albright, Penn State, Berks, all have some interesting sustainability efforts. Penn State Berks has rain gardens and solar panels and LEED buildings.
They do have some LEED buildings, the Fred Gage building.
Gage building, we forgot earlier. Albright has its LEED buildings. They have a whole eco house where students learn to live sustainably, which is not always easy. So you can read their blogs about how to take a 5-minute shower kind of stuff. But there's a lot of interesting things happening. Something as simple as removing the dining hall trays. So when you go through the dining hall, you carry it on a plate instead of a tray, which has significantly reduced food waste, which has reduced costs, which has actually helped students be a little bit healthier, and it's all kind of a sustainability message.
Well, I imagine you don't have to wash these trays either.
And save the water.
We could talk a lot about, but let's move on to the next one because I think it's a very interesting one, the growing family businesses. I think, you know, there were interesting lessons from that you got.
Yeah. One of the favorite stories as I was kind of talking with folks and interviewing, I interviewed Tim Keeler. He's a third generation business owner. It's now called Proasis, but originally I think it was Keeler Companies or something of that nature. His grandfather started the business cleaning cooling towers.
Huh.
Because it had to be done, all right? But what happens is when you clean one of those cooling towers, you're actually improving the efficiency of the cooling tower. So you're reducing the amount of water that's needed, you're reducing the amount of electricity that's needed. And no one really thought about that. His grandfather didn't think about it those ways. His father, who Tim bought the business from, didn't really think about it those ways. But Tim, being a young millennial, he went and studied at Arizona, NAU, Northern Arizona University, studied environmental science, didn't think he had any interest in the family business. But when he came back to the family business and looked at what they were doing, he realized, wow, my grandfather started a green company. My grandfather started a company that was all about sustainability, that's helping protect the planet.
Yeah.
And Tim was like, I'm in. And then he took things a bit further because he actually started examining the chemicals that are used to clean the cooling towers and realized there were green chemicals that could be used to clean those cooling towers. So now he's providing this environmental service that can be arguably saying is helping reduce the threat of climate change, using green cleaning chemicals, and his business is booming as a result because there's a variety of businesses that have gone green that want to use a green company to do those kinds of things. So he talked about a number of contracts, a lot of universities that have said, hey, we want you to come do it. Anybody could be doing it. He's got competitors.
Yeah, but.
But because he's reframed this as an environmental story with green chemicals, business is booming.
Wow, that illustrates so many points. Kind of the ripple effect of somebody doing something that is good for all of us, hits the triple bottom line, and encourages other people to do the same. Okay, that's kind of a good lead into the next topic.
We can show the graphic real fast. When we talked about what Proasis was doing and using green cleaning products, we actually have a company here in Reading, Misco Products. And Misco Products was one of the earliest manufacturers of green cleaning products. You can actually see in the picture, they've got solar panels on the roof. You can see a variety of the cleaning products that are used to clean hospitals and hotels and big buildings. They're not the kind of thing you and I would use to clean our house.
Yeah, it's commercial cleaning.
Cleaning products. Mm-hmm. And they've actually been certified as greener products with the Safer Choice program. So you can kind of bounce away from that. But what was fascinating is this is a company that discovered the green cleaning movement early, rapidly grew their business because they were one of the first to start talking about it. And then as the rest of the industry kind of caught up, they already had a much bigger market share. They had a great story to tell, lots of history. It's a great local company with some really cool people that work there.
And so here we are, Misco Products in Berks County.
Yep.
Not only serving Berks County, but a much broader region. Yeah, that's great. Okay, let's go on to the next topic. What does it mean?
So we've got a quick image here, but sustainability means innovation. It's thinking about your business differently. And this was kind of one of my favorite stories. I went into the mushroom houses over at Giorgio. And you can bounce away from the picture because at lunchtime I'm getting hungry here. But Giorgio, which I didn't really think about as a sustainability company. I mean, they grew stuff. I knew they sold organic. That was good enough for me. But they actually do some pretty innovative things with integrated pest management. So some mushroom companies spray chemicals to keep bugs and stuff off the mushrooms. What Giorgio actually does, they have a parasitic wasp that they release because this parasitic wasp eats the bugs that might be harming the mushrooms.
Wow.
So they have this whole innovative, integrated pest management approach. And I didn't even know about it. This is one of the most innovative things I'd seen in a while. And it's right here in Berks County. When you listen to the folks at Giorgio talk about it, that's just the right way to do it. It's economical. It makes sense. It's the way nature does it. it wasn't a sustainability story. It was a Pennsylvania Dutch common sense kind of story.
Although, Giorgio, a generation or two ago, they were immigrants. It was an immigrant Italian family that came here and made good in America. All right, so let's see how many more we quickly go through here, because we've got to wrap up. Another aspect, again, what we don't think about was, pick the one.
We'll just pick the top you want to hit on. Throw this screen up, and I'll talk fast here. Sustainability means happy pigs.
Right, good.
We found some really innovative companies that, rather than paying to get rid of their trash, are feeding it to the pigs. The folks at R.M. Palmer feed waste chocolate to the pigs. The folks at... Appealing Fruit have all sorts of apple waste that they feed to the pigs. In fact, their waste water was going to be incredibly expensive to dispose of in the local sewer systems because it had a high sugar content washing apples.
Yeah.
So they take that water, rather than dumping it in the sewers, rather than filtering it in this expensive process, they feed the apple juice to the pigs. So they're quite happy. Saucony Creek Brewery actually feeds the waste stuff from the beer making process to local pigs. So last scene here, sustainability means better beer. Saucony Creek Brewery, just as an example, donates some money when you buy certain beers, Stonefly IPA, for example, to local water protection groups. Why? Because better water means better beer.
Yeah.
And they actually understand that connection. Saucony Creek, which is getting ready to open up a new place in downtown Redding.
Down in there.
Reusing an old building, which also, I
was part of that project. We did not go for LEED certification, but we followed the LEED guidelines on that project.
Perfect. So now they're moving into a green building in downtown Redding, helping revitalize downtown, recycling Redding, if you will.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
revitalizing downtown Redding.
Fits so much.
We can talk about that over beer. There's a lot
over
to say
beer.
About
I think it's
that.
A great place to finish. Scott, I want to thank you again for being part of this. I think this is a great discussion. We could do another 2 half-hour segments. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in. The next program will be April 24th at 10 a.m. Again, you can stream this and all the other great programming at BCTV at bctv.org at BCTV's YouTube station. Thank you. See you next month.
Thanks, Bill.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.